Okay, so good morning. Just for your information and confirmation, the most of the January, no, actually all of the January classes are now on YouTube. And I think the February ones are very close to be, if they're not already, I haven't checked the last days. So today we're traveling from England to Spain and Portugal. And we're going to concentrate, of course, on the 18th century art, which is going to be translated mostly in architecture, but we'll see a little bit of painting too. So I want to start, as usual, with a few dates and facts. The very big turning point in Spain is going to be 1700, when Charles II is going to die and leave no heirs. We'll talk a little bit about him in a minute. And so there is a big tension in Europe because Spain is a very big chunk of the European territory, and they didn't want to have as a successor to Charles II another big power that would really break the balance between the different countries. It ends up anyway with exactly that, because Charles II is going to be succeeded by his French great nephew, Philippe of Anjou. This anyway will trigger a war of succession that will start in 1700 and will last until 1714. But in the meantime, Philippe of Anjou is going to already take the crown of Spain. At the end of the War of Succession is signed the Treaty of Utrecht, where Spain is going to lose the Netherlands. The Netherlands had been the possession of the Spanish Habsburg since the birth of Charles V of Spain, who became the Holy Roman Emperor. And at that time, Spain loses the Netherlands to the profit of the Austrian Habsburg. And so that is just, the Netherlands won't move, but they will depend entirely from Austria from that time on. The arrival of Philippe of Anjou is going to change many things, particularly in art for us. He will create the Royal Tapestry Factory, because most of the tapestries were coming from the Netherlands. Brussels and Malines were great centers for tapestry weaving. And so as they lose their direct access to the Netherlands, they decide to create their very own. And they're actually bringing some workers from the Netherlands to open these tapestry factories. The taste of the court is also going to change because of the import of many French painters. They also will be some typical of the 17th, 18th century small genre paintings. Michel-Ange Wass is one of the French painters that's going to provide that. But we have Spanish painters that follow really the beautiful tradition of still lifes with Luis Meléndez, and some landscapes and other interesting paintings. You'll see a few examples by Luis Paredes Alcázar. These are very, in the sense, they've become an opposition to the established Royal Academy of San Fernando, which is going to be rather rigid. Because of the arrival of a new French king, they call on French painters. Jean Roc, Louis-Michel Vanloo are two of the many that will come. Then, jumping to 1760, Carlos III will succeed. We'll see a little bit of the succession of kings. Carlos had been in Naples that belonged to Spain at that time, and will succeed to his father. And when he arrives to Spain, the shift from French taste is going to go to Italian taste, where he's coming from. And so he's going to bring in Tiepolo, for example, and a German painter, but who was working in Italy, Anton Raphael Mengs. So let's now look at the change of dynasty with some painting. It's at the same time a really good way to see the change in taste. So here we go back to the 17th century with two paintings by Velázquez, showing on your left the King Philip IV as a huntsman, the typical Habsburg with the prognated chin and the eyes that are rather bulbous. And then Marianne of Austria on the right, who is in the typical attire, Spanish attire at the time. Their eldest son, Charles II, is unfortunately a disaster. He was physically and mentally disabled and infertile. This is most probably due, and I think there's no doubt it is due, to the massive inbreeding in that family, where they were so eager to keep the blood in that line. They just, so many first cousins married that it was a real problem. So he succeeded actually after the death of his half-brothers who were before him, but died also. And this is all due to the inbreeding too. The poor Charles did not learn to speak until the age of 4, not to walk until the age of 8. He was treated as virtually an infant until he was 10 years old. The jaw, as you can see, was so deformed, what is called the Habsburg jaw, that he could barely speak or chew. And fearing that the poor child would be overtaxed, the caretaker didn't force Charles to attend school. So this became, a cascading problem. So finally, and apparently he wasn't bathing quite often either. So the result is that they're looking for a successor, and the closest successor is the Philip of Orléans, who is actually a grandson of a Spanish Habsburg. So let's look at it. This is by Jean Rond, one of the French painters that came to Spain with Philip. Is here the representation of Philip V shortly after he became king. He is the son of Louis de France, who was the eldest son of Louis XIV that we see there. We have to realize that when Louis XIV died, he died in 1715, had the longest reign of all the monarchs in Europe at that time. Louis XIV died, Louis of France had died in 1711, and his two eldest sons had died the year after, all of smallpox. So how do we have that filiation to Spain? Here it is. Louis XIV was married to the Infanta Maria Teresa. We see here a portrait by Velázquez of the Infanta. And of course, once she moved to France, she switched the attire from the Spanish to the French fashion and became a very typical French woman with the beautiful French fashion. So it's quite interesting to see the same woman in two different attires. So it is because of the proximity to Maria Theresa of Spain that Philip V became the natural, in quote, heir to the crown of Spain. He came to Spain and first married Queen Maria Luisa of Savoy, who unfortunately died in 1714. This was taken 2 years before she died. Where we see a woman that was raised pretty much in the countryside, but had learned to hunt. And that's why she's shown here with a rifle. So to show that she was pretty good at hunting. At her death, she will be replaced by Queen Isabel de Farnesio. So that tells you one thing. She was raised in Parma and came, was extremely learned. She had learned to speak and write Latin, French, German, and was schooled in rhetoric, philosophy, geography, and history. But she was also a very good student in dance and studied painting and enjoyed music and embroidery, which made her a well-rounded woman. So what is interesting, she was a very strong character. And so she very quickly obtained complete influence on Philip, who was very happy about it. He wished to be dominated. So we also see there the Melendez painter, more into the following of Velázquez, whereas the Louis-Michel Van Loo is typical of the French school in the representation too. Here by the same painter, Louis-Michel Van Loo, is the family of Philippe V. So you can see a numerous family. We have the future king who is standing there. We have them all well represented. Actually, these two were future, were in the line. And then because of the death, early death of one, this is what happened. You have that cascading velvet drapery coming from behind the columns. You have the little group, group of musicians playing at that balcony. Very rich architecture, as you can see. Now, after Philippe V, will come Louis I, painted also by Jean Ranc in Spain. You can see the typical portrait. This is very much a legacy from the Van Dyck portraits, particularly in England and in Antwerp. Because of his early death, he will be very quickly succeeded by Ferdinand VI, another painting by Louis-Michel Van Loo. He was born at the Royal Alcázar of Madrid, and his youth was really hard because his father's second wife was a very demeaning woman, as we have talked about it, and gave them absolutely no affection. So for Ferdinand VI, what was important was hunting and music. These were his two big pleasures. So finally, Charles III, who will succeed. This is a painting by the German Anton Raphael Mengs, but who had been brought in into Spain, and is really the initiator, by the way, of the neoclassical style that we will see, I think, in months. So this, we're reaching now the end of the Rococo, though this is still a very official portrait. So the neoclassical side of Mengs doesn't come out as much. Despite his funny physique, Charles III was a really good man. He was a product of the second marriage of his father, so to Isabel of Parma. He went actually, as he succeeded to the throne of Naples in Sicily, he went there and stayed in there until the death of his father and of his brother, and then was forced to come back. His wife was the Queen Elizabeth of Parma with their elder son, Charles. And here we have again, Miguel Jacinto Melendez, who is the artist. So what is interesting, and we'll see, I'm now bringing in the future part of the talk, is the fact that the court wasn't remaining at one place, and we'll see many palaces, and this can be explained by their schedule. So the yearly schedule would be, we plan most of the winter in Madrid, the early part of January in the Palace of El Pardo. After the Holy Week, they move to Aranjuez. In July, they stay in La Granja. In October, in the Escurial. And then they come back on the 10th of December to Madrid. This can be in many ways explained by the fact that the when the royals were in the place, of course, the whole court was staying around. And that involved a lot of needs for food, and everything that goes around. And so typically one of these places couldn't sustain the life of the court for a whole year. And so that was the only way, was to go from one place to the other, and so be able to fulfill the needs of the court. Following Charles the Third, we'll have Charles the Fourth, who was the king that reigned for most the part the time of Francisco Goya's career. He was a very different character. His father was quite a smart guy who tried to really bring some new ideas, the Enlightenment, to Spain, though a lot of the nobility resisted him. So in this case, he became a king in 1788 and then had to abdicate in 1808 and then was brought back for a short period of time. His wife, Maria Luisa of Parma, was quite a character. And we know that not a lot of things have been said about it. She was, as you can see, a pretty woman in her youth, turned out not as pretty later on, but was particularly known for a special life. She didn't care too much for her husband and was pretty obvious in having an affair with her prime minister that lasted quite a long time. So here it's interesting to see the portrait by Francisco Goya on the left, still a rather formal portrait, though the background shows a very different interest to compare to the others. And on the right, we have Anton Mengs, as I say, the initiator of the neoclassical style in Europe. Other painters, Luis Barreti Alcázar shows here, really for us, I think it's quite interesting to see the way of life of all these royals within the court. And we have to dismiss in this particular picture the scale of the room. It's no way the scale that the room is so big. But this is Charles III dining in presence of his court. And if I don't make a mistake, this could be in the new palace. It wouldn't be in the Alcázar because the Alcázar burned down, and we'll talk about that later on, and was replaced by the royal palace that is now the one you see in Madrid. But it's really interesting to see. I always love the fact they always dogs in these, so there's at least four that we can see here. And the king is, of course, behind the table. All the servants are coming in, but you have the court just roaming around. On the walls, I want to attract your attention to tapestries. As you can see, these are not paintings. These are tapestries, and would be much easier to hang than having paintings of that size. So these tapestries were moved around depending on the season. And often these series of tapestry would move around with the family and be hung in the different other palaces later. Another painting by Pared y Alcázar is Las Parejas Reales in Aranjuez. It's obviously one of the big entertainment taking place in the gardens of the beautiful palace of Aranjuez. It shows, of course, the tribune with the king and the court, and then have all the cavaliers doing almost like a dance. You can see them moving along. So these were part of the entertainment of the royal family and the nobility that was living around them. I think it's always kind of documentary for us. Beside these very formal pictures, we have some of these beautiful still lifes that are very much following to the marvelous tradition of still life in Spain, so different to the rest of Europe at that time. This is bodegón con jamón, huevos y recipientes, the still life with ham and eggs. And for those of you that paint, still life might be sometimes strange, but it really shows off the skills of a painter at rendering all these different texture and the reflection of light on different metals or potteries or piece of meat. Then nice little domestic life genre painting. This is by Ramon Bayeux that shows the young men playing guitar with two women in conversation. But this has, compared to what we'll see in a minute of Goya, a very different flavor. This is overly sweet, if you can look at it. And you look at the features of the man, they're very tiny, very Rococo type of painting. This is going to be completely changed when Goya comes into the pictures. And this is a cartoon that he's, when I talk about the cartoon, it's literally a painting that will be reproduced as a tapestry. This is the way that Goya started his career, is he got hired at the new tapestry factory to prepare cartoons for different palaces belonging to the king and then to other aristocrats living around the king. And the marvelous early works by Goya show these very accurate moments with population having some leisure. Of course, this is, I wouldn't say idealized, but it's showing the nice moment of the population. Obviously, we know that there was a lot of poverty too. But this is a joyous moment showing the young men and women that are not wearing, by the way, the clothes that was fashionable at that time, that had moved from Spanish fashion to French fashion, but are insisting in wearing clothes that are very traditional in Spain. That's why they call them majos. And the Manzanares River is the one that is around, that runs around Madrid. Same thing here, you see majos and majas. A walk in Andalusia, the main fashion that became popular at that time were the clothes worn in Andalusia. And so the men would wear these dark hats and the capes that they would surround themselves with. And women would wear the big dresses with bright colored scarves. And then, of course, the lace veil that they wear on their hair. This actually became for men, the fashion of the large hat and the cape became forbidden and caused a whole revolution, by the way. You can see the men sitting on the left there, is showing a sword, which they were not allowed to wear normally, but that could be easily hidden under the cape. This was, of course, was a protest against French influence. Also, these are all cartoons, by the way. The early works of Goya's are mostly cartoons, except for the few portraits he did at that time. But he was receiving, he made altogether, I think, 80 cartoons for the king and the heir to the throne. He also did part of the cartoons that he did for the tapestry were not as positive, but depended on the season. And so, for example, on the left, you have the snowstorm that obviously would hang in the rooms during the winter. And then they would rotate these tapestries with a more springy one in the spring or summery one in the summer. So here is the snowstorm that shows obviously a family struggling with the mule in the back, trying to go through the pretty tough climate that you can find in the high plateau in Spain. Or on the right, you have the injured mason. There's a double entente there. It could be that he got injured by lack of security in the building, or because he had too much to drink. That's possible too. So this gives you a little panorama of the kind of different paintings that coexisted at that time in Spain. So moving to the architecture in Spain, we have to see what existed. And what we have mostly in the 17th century is the Baroque, but that translates into a rather sober Baroque in Spain. That comes from Italy, penetrated across the Pyrenees, and started moving away from the super classical style of Juan de Herrera, the one who had built the Escorial, for example. And we'll see that, again, as we see in painting, where we have coexistence of different styles, in the architecture is going to be the same thing. There are some particular styles that come out as the Churrigueresque, as I mentioned in the title. But we have different reactions against that very, very sober, super classical architecture of Juan de Herrera and other architects of the 17th century. Here is the facade of the Granada Cathedral by Alonso Cano at the end of the 17th century, where we see a Baroque that is very different to what we can see in some places in Italy or in the north. So you have a look at what Alberti was doing in the early Renaissance, but then some modulation of the facade with the play of shadows by the fact that you have the orders, the columns are coming forward, and the facade is in the back, so you have a play of light with it. So you definitely have the triumphal art, which we find in Alberti's architecture in Mantua, for example, but also mixed with some details that are more Baroque, like these type of finials and the medallions on the columns. Another example of that late Baroque in Spain is the facade of the Jaén Cathedral by Eufrasio López de Rojas. This is one of the most Renaissance cathedral, but that has been upgraded in the end of the 17th century to bring some more Baroque details. And the portal is definitely a more Baroque touch to an otherwise rather Renaissance church. It's a huge church, by the way. So what we will see is a lot of buildings, palaces or churches that have been built earlier and then have been remodeled with Baroque and Churrigueresque or Rococo details. One good example is the famous royal palace of Aranjuez that was started by Juan de Herrera, the one that did the Escorial, and then was continued by some Italian architect, and I only name one, Francesco Sabatini, that was brought in by the court. And so that palace that was very Renaissance, and you can still see the Renaissance windows with the different decoration, is then rehabbed, if you want, with these type of additions that are much more Baroque, more curvilinear, and different, with different angles and statues on top, etc. The two wings that are on either side of the central body of the chateau have also been added in the 18th century. It is Philip V in 1700 that decided to resume the work. He wanted to make Aranjuez a rival of the Grand Palace of Versailles. And then Ferdinand VI rebuilt the palace again, added some Baroque style things, and particularly in the inside, there are some views such as that grand staircase that show a more Baroque approach, though still pretty tamed. As all the palaces that we have seen, if you remember, in Germany or in Austria, of course, the palace had to have its Chinese porcelain cabinet. That is, this one's absolutely extravagant and marvelous, mixing the reflection of these mirrors and the whole decoration that runs in porcelain and that is applied to the walls and with all the Chinese motifs. That was commissioned by Charles III, and it was a work of the Royal Porcelain Factory of Buen Retiro in Madrid. The floor is of marble. The purpose of the room was to be a game room and playground. Pretty fancy for that. In the 18th century, the Alcazar, which was the old Moorish Alcazar that had been taken over by the kings, and when they moved the court to Madrid, transformed into the royal palace, was not a particularly comfortable fitting. Unfortunately, caught fire on Christmas, and that was in, I think, 1740, and sorry, I don't have the perfect date. And the king called at that time Huvaha. By the way, that fire was terrible because it destroyed an enormous part of the large collection of paintings that were held in the palace. Fortunately, Las Meninas by Velázquez escaped the fire. The people made it a living chain and saved many of the works of arts, but that one of them was Las Meninas. So in 1738, the king called on an Italian architect, very known in the region of Turin, to make a plan, design the new Palacio Real. And so Huvaha, who was very known and appreciated in Italy, came and designed the palace. He unfortunately died precociously, and so the work was done by some of his assistant. But you can see here a work that is actually not neoclassical as you would believe because of the number of columns and the rather vertical aspect of it, but actually a tamed Baroque that was the wish of the king. But you have the cupola and these balconies all around that are in a sense almost reminiscent of the Bernini square at the Vatican. Within the Palacio Real, the king had also called the very known Italian Rococo painter Gian Battista Tiepolo, who made the whole program. He came with his two sons, who were his assistant, and then decorated most of the ceilings in the palace. And this, of course, is the apotheosis of the Spanish monarchy. That is a typical program that Tiepolo used in different ways. Tiepolo was the arch Rococo painter of his time, had worked a lot in Venice, in the surrounding of Venice, and then in southern Germany. Unfortunately for him, Gian Battista was getting old at that time. And shortly after his arrival came the German Anton Mengs, who completely dismissed the old artist. And Gian Battista died in Madrid, absolutely discouraged and pained by what Anton Mang was doing. And there will be the shift from Rococo to neoclassical art around that time. It is also Juvara in Italian, that is going to have the last hand at the redesign of the La Granja Palace in San Ildefonso. He is going to remodel the central part of the garden facade of the palace. This 18th century palace was formerly the summer residence of the King of Spain since the reign of Philip V. It is again a very restrained, typically French. French Baroque is extremely restrained, and Philip V definitely had his hand on that. And so the palace is surrounded by extensive garden in the French manner, with sculptural fountains and grottos and everything that went together with a French palace at the time, and actually also influenced by Italy. Here is the court of honor that is in a sense reminiscent of Versailles too. And then grottos and the gardens with beautiful fountains found all around. And again, because Juvara died early, he was succeeded by some other Italian architects and designers who came and assisted him. So as I gave you the title of the Churrigueresque architecture, I better talk about it. The name comes from the Chihuguera family, and I apologize for any Spanish-speaking person who is looking, but I can't pronounce the R. I'm typically French-speaking, can't pronounce the R. So you'll have to bear with me. The main figures in the families are José Benito Chihuguera, his two sons, Nicolás and Jerónimo, and then his two brothers, Joaquín, Alberto, and the two children of the daughter, Mariana, who's going to marry an architect. Both Manuel and Jose are not going to be architects, but sculptors. All the others do both. They're sculptors and architects. What is the, the Churrigueresque style. So the Churrigueresque family was specialized in designing altars and retables. And there are some that revolted the most drastically against the sobriety of the Juan de Herrera classicism, and then promoted a very opposite style, which is intricate, exaggerated, almost capricious style of surface decoration. And that has taken their name. That's why you have that very complicated Churrigueresque denomination. The Churrigueresque went through three phases. From 1680 to 1720, the Churrigueresque popularized another architect, Italian architect, Guarino Guarini's blend of Solomonic columns and composite orders, known as supreme orders. The Solomonic columns, if you have want to, an example, is the Bernini beautiful altar, I'm blanking out to tell you, it's that beautiful protection, if you want, of the main altar in St. Peter, the baldacchino, that's it. The baldacchino is a typical Solomonic, has the Solomonic columns. These are torus columns that turn. And composite orders is, an order is a column, the style of column in Greece. So the composite order are pretty much what you would have with acanthus leaves at the capital. That's what became called as the supreme order. By 1720 to 1760, the Churrigueresque column, or estipite, is in the shape of an inverted cone or obelisk, and was established as the central element of ornamental decoration. I think we can see one of them. And then between 1760 and 80, we see a gradual shift of interest away from the twisted movement towards something more neoclassical and sober. So let's look at one of the first work, and of course the church itself, which is extraordinary in Salamanca, the Iglesia del Convento de San Esteban, shows that extraordinary plateresque style that is particular to Spain during the Renaissance, with a facade that in fact gives you already an idea of what you're going to find inside. Very often when you have that kind of plateresque architecture, it is almost an exterior representation of what the retablo is going to show inside. You have crucifixion here with Mary and John, a whole series of saints. It's extraordinary. Salamanca is really going to become one of the centers of Churrigueresque art. And you have to go into the convent, the monastery, to find one of the works by José de Churriguera, which is the reredo or retable on the main altar. And here you can find these famous Solomonesque columns, or torus columns with a series of spirals with vines climbing on it. And this was very typical. And then you have in the center that kind of building of its own that has the host, is keeping the host when the church is not in function. Of course, everything is covered with gold. Typical of these late Baroque altarpiece. Another work, Churrigueresque work, is that facade that is, again, it's a much more Renaissance facade. You can, typical Renaissance windows, but that have been then completed and upgraded probably by José de Churrigueresque and Pedro de Ribera, who was one of the architects working with him, showing the facade of granite. And then you have the three arches and the much more complicated, sophisticated entrance than the rest of the facade, which is, in fact, goes back to the ideas of Brunelleschi, of the Pietra Serena in Italy, but here not with a white background, with a pink brick. In the Cathedral of Segovia, the Sagrario is again a work by José de Churrigueresque. You have the torus column and the central motif there with a whole construction with Christ and a series of cherubs all around. Another statue of Christ on the top, and then different cherubs, but very, as you can see, extremely intricate, a lot of gold, as the Spaniards really liked. Again, back to Salamanca. As I said, this is a city that has been very marked by the Churrigueresque. This was by Joaquín de Churrigueresque and his brother Alberto. The sculptures were by other artists. And what you see is what is called the choir in Salamanca, as it was the case in many, in most of the churches at that time. You had the, before the main altar, you had that screen that would prevent, in effect, the regular believers to see what was happening, but to make sure that the community of the monastery or the canons would have their intimacy, if you want, and they would be able to see what's happening on the main altar. Often you had another altar here where sometimes you had smaller masses for the crowd. As you can see, very beautiful architecture and design for that screen, as well as the design of the choir, where they didn't sculpt themselves, but they made the whole design of this. This would be the back of the screen here. You can see the balcony in the back that you see here. So you see that extremely intricate pews for all the canons. The Plaza Mayor in Salamanca is also a product of the Churrigueresque family. Construction began in 1729, was completed in 1755. The plaza was used for a while for bullfighting until literally the mid 19th century, and since then has become place of gathering with shops and cafes all around. Again, you can see the very typical motifs that you saw in Aranjuez and other places. Originally, two towers were supposed to come up here. You can see the model showing, but the towers were never completed. It would have made the whole design much more balanced. Then I'm going to show you a few churches. This is the Iglesia de San Francisco Javier in Nuevo Bastan, not very far from Madrid. And again, you see a much more sophisticated portico compared to the rest of the church that is very classical. It is part of the Palacio de Goyeneche that was constructed between 709 and 713 also. So that was the church belonging to the palazzo. They were instrumental also in the sacristy of the Charter House of Granada. Where they really work, and, you know, beautiful sculpted work sometimes for us it's overly done, but has an interesting impact on the reflection of light. As you can see, it is rather light, but the play of light on all these different surfaces was quite interesting. One of the most known Churrigueresque piece is the piece of El Transparente in the Cathedral of Toledo, but not by the Churrigueresque themselves, but by a follower, Narciso Tomé, who painted it. This is extremely known. It's in the ambulatory of the Cathedral of Toledo. And the name comes from that absolutely unique illumination that is provided by a very large skylight cut very high into the thick wall across from the ambulatory that really projects the light on the amazing construction of the El Transparente. It was created in 1729-32 by Narciso Tomé and his four sons. Two were architects, one painter and one sculptor. The mixed materials, marble, bronze, paint, stucco. This also shows some influence of the Bernini's Cathedra Petri at the very back of the St. Peter, the chair of St. Peter. Here is another angle to see El Transparente, showing you. So what we saw is here on the right. But then the whole place is then surrounded by a series of Gothic looking sculptures and like a lace work. The same Diego Tomé did the facade of the university building in Valladolid. This is now housing the Faculty of Law. It was built in 1750. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a better image, but it gives you again that feeling of emphasis on the main entrance with columns and look like Corinthian columns, but are more sophisticated than even the Corinthian columns. Another of their followers is Pedro de Ribera. This is the facade of the the facade of the Hospicio de San Fernando, which is now the Museum of History in Madrid. And that beautiful facade, I love that, that kind of sustained pink with the gray accent of the granite stone. And then here is the typical Churrigueresque accent by Pedro de Ribera, who is one of the followers of the Churriguera. And here is a detail of that accent showing San Fernando in the niche above the entrance. It looks like a monumental sculpture when you look at it. Here, the Palacio de Santa Cruz in Valladolid also. And here we can see that kind of obelisk that they were talking about, these motifs that are part of that second stage of the Churrigueresque style. This is now the library in Valladolid, the main library. All the way to the northwest of Spain, we have that famous Obradorio square on which is the Cathedral of Santiago de Compostela. And it's really interesting to see the contrast of architecture because we have some very Renaissance building. And then this one that was built by Carlos Lemoore, who is a French architect, and is in fact the building where you have the administration of the government in Santiago. the Paso de Hajo, and I don't pronounce well the idiom used in Galicia, but that was built at the end of the 18th century, very much in contrast that very neoclassical facade with the pediment and all the orders and so on, is in great contrast with what is across from it, the Cathedral of Santiago de Compostela, which facade, with the church itself is a completely Romanesque work, extraordinary work. But they thought that the facade wasn't elaborate enough. And so in the 1700, they had the facade kind of putting, it's just applied to the original facade. So this is called the Obraidojo facade, which is on the square of the Obraidojo, and was built in 1700. But as soon as you get into these gates and you have that extraordinary Romanesque portico, so this is very much of a Churrigueresque type of work, very sophisticated, no restraint at all. Now, in the climate in Galicia, in Santiago de Compostela, it gets very humid. And so the facade sometimes turns green because of the algae growing on the stone. Moving south to Sevilla, this is another example of the influence of the Churrigueresque architecture. This becomes more civilian in style, but it definitely is showing that influence with the central portico of the Palazzo de San Telmo. Columns, but these are not the Solomonic columns, they're by now straight, but as you can see, very, very worked, very ornated, sorry. In Valencia, we're going back north on the coast, the palace of the Marqués de Dos Aguas is a very good representative of the Baroque. Again, this becomes then the influence of the Churriguera family, but mixed with the taste for the Baroque for the Spaniards. The portico is full of history, full of mythological things. You have on this side, you have two heads of crocodiles coming up with the two giants. Here we have a reclined lion that is next to a jar that is upturned and flowing water from it. An image of the Virgin and Child on top. And so a multiplicity of symbolism all around. And as you can see, the windows themselves are very highly decorated. Here's another image of these windows. In Murcia, the Cathedral of Murcia shows another kind of Gothic. This is not anymore Churrigueresque, but it's just another style with the tower. As you can see, the church was built originally in 1521 and then was finished, completed by 1791. So we have a succession of style that come, and where we have sometimes a building, we'll see mostly in Portugal, a very simple facade, but it is prone to be ornated later on if needed. So for example, the tower that we see at the back here is a Renaissance tower until it comes here at the end here, that the upper part is Baroque. Now the interior is largely Gothic in style, which is quite interesting, interesting contrast. the huge Our Lady of the Pillar in Saragossa is quite interesting too. Here is a beautiful night view of the cathedral. The Lady of the Pillar is that statue which has been replaced during the Renaissance, because the previous one had burned in the terrible fire that demolished the old church, but brings a lot of pilgrims. These are all miraculous statues. And here is the facade of the Cathedral of Saragossa. It was again started as a rather tame Baroque and then ended up in an incredible building with multiple roof lines and little towers with colored tiles. So it's very much a style of its own. What is incredible is during the Spanish Civil War, between 1936 and 39, three bombs were dropped on the church and none of them exploded. Two of them are still shown in the Basilica, by the way. And to tell you, Churrigueresque has had tremendous influence on the New World, and we'll see that in 2 weeks, where this is probably where the Churrigueresque style is the most frequent, but also in the south of the United States, in San Diego, in California. If you go to the Balboa Park, the Casa del Prado Theater is a very typical Churrigueresque architecture, renewal, of course, revival. So I'll give you 5 minutes, not more, to now stretch your legs. Please ask me questions, and we'll move to Portugal, where we have to see a lot of things. So unmute yourself and talk to me. Are you enjoying it, Bill?
I'm just saying how incredible some of these buildings are. I've driven through Spain, but I didn't appreciate the different periods that I was looking at.
Yeah, but that's often the problem, is that we go there pretty blind and saying, oh, it's beautiful, but you don't really understand what it is.
It is, and it's exactly what I was going to say, because I've been to Granada and I was fascinated with Alhambra and the Roman rooms. And you go there, even in the tourist house, they don't talk so much. They don't show pictures or pamphlets of these historical buildings and churches. I feel that I need to go back again. And
If you go to Granada, definitely you go to the cathedral, because there is the mausoleum there. It is extraordinary in the cathedral. It's a different entrance, but it ends up in a chapel on the side, where you have the nine figures of the kings of, I think it's the Catholic kings are there, I think. If I don't remember well who it is, but the mausoleum is superb. And there are also a pretty good collection of Flemish paintings.
Beautiful collection. That is a fabulous place to visit.
Yeah, but I love the Alhambra. I love the Alhambra.
Oh, the Alhambra. Where Ferdinand and Isabella are.
Yeah.
And then you go around behind the altar down into where they're actually entombed.
It's beautiful. I always show it when we go. I did show it when I was talking about Andalusia. Yes.
Thank you for mentioning the New World, because that was my question as I was looking at them, because they seem so familiar.
Oh, very much. And that's in 2 weeks. I'm going to have a whole class on the New World. And it's incredible to see the architecture from
it transferred.
Mexico to Peru, and you have and Brazil. I found some. We have a Brazilian among us, so we have to make sure we respect his country.
And one question on the in this huge, fantastic church. How were they financed in Spain? Was the church financing? Was the crowd?
No. The church was always financed by people around, and the church was so powerful that you had to be in the good grace of the church. So you had contribution typically from the king, but all the guilds and all the merchants and so on would participate, and the regular people, they would give. It was so important for them. You know, nowadays they build big football stadium. Now at that time, the cathedral was what was putting the city on the map.
Yeah.
Well, there was a competition. When you see Saragossa, that huge, huge cathedral, and it's incredible. So at that time, it was so important to have the most beautiful and the largest cathedral, larger than the city next and so on. So yeah, the whole population was participating but especially the nobles around. And in some cases, in some convents, there was a lot of money at that time. And they were at that time importing all that precious metal from Mexico and from Peru and so on. So there was money, but that's why they went bankrupt at the end. they spent it all. Mm-hmm. But it's amazing when you see the construction. Look in France, the number of cathedrals, incredible cathedrals. Where did they get the money? Yeah, the labor wasn't as expensive as it is now either. The people were not paid the same way. Mm-hmm. So that was all easier. The question was to find the material. Anyway, but I think it's, this is different. For me, sometimes it's difficult to go because you don't really have a narrative, but it's extraordinary to see some of these works around. And 18th century is a century that is often forgotten. The most important thing about it is the Enlightenment and how it changed the face of Europe. But itself, it's often looking for, it's a successor of the Baroque period, which itself is the successor of the Renaissance. And so they're not quite sure where they are. That's why you have such an incredible variety of style in the 18th century.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see, let me see when it's gonna be. Neoclassicism is going to be 15th of April. We'll talk just about neoclassicism, and that's going to be the total shift from the Rococo to something very sober and cold, with all kind of dogmas and ideas behind it that's going to lead to the revolution. So it has so much to do with also, as you've seen in Spain, we have that shift from the Habsburg to the Bourbon, the French Bourbon. And this is gonna change completely the style that they're going to use. They go to French style. And then you have Carlos coming back from Naples and he wants Italian. And so that's why we have such a variety. It's quite interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm going to go on because otherwise you're here until 1 o'clock. I'm going to mute you again. Let me see where if I can. And then we'll talk at the end. And now we are going to move to Portugal. If I must, yeah. And look at what is going to make Portugal different. So it's a special situation and a different timeline than we have from the rest of Europe. They're not going to be at the forefront of Enlightenment, definitely. But there are lots of changes in Portugal at that time. So you have political factors because you had a union, 60-year union between Portugal and Spain, where it is going to be the Habsburg that are going to become the kings until they revolt against it. Artistic, again, depending on what is the main influence, typically coming from the court, you have more French, Spanish, or other type of influences. And economic too. In economic factors, we keep often forgetting the English are also going to have some influence because of their love for the Navy, and that goes around, and we have lots of people that are going to try to enter Portugal and the southern part of Spain. So a whole series of outside influence that we will see. As I mentioned, we have the financial effort for the kingdom that is channeled through to the Portuguese Restoration War after the Union. That's why when you go to Portugal, don't speak Spanish, they don't really like it. Another key factor is the existence of the Jesuitical architecture. That's also called plain style, estilo chao, and I don't speak Portuguese, so I hope John forgets me. I'm going to try not to pronounce it. The buildings are very often single room basilica, the Jesuit buildings, of course, deep main chapel, lateral chapels with small door for communication. But what happens is that's a really practical way because they built something simple, and then with a few adjustments, they're going to be decorated later when the money is available. And sometimes we see these super simple building, and then they add a portico. So let's look at the map to understand what happened during the Iberic Union of between 1580 and 1640, where the Habsburg will become kings of Portugal too. Philip II of Spain will become Philip I of Portugal. In red, you have the territories owned by Spain, and in blue, by Portugal. Now, you put that together and you have the Iberic Union. But as we say, this will happen, we will have then the end in 1640, between 1595 to 1663, we have Dutch-Portuguese War that involves Dutch companies and invading many Portuguese colonies and commercial interest in Brazil, in Africa, India, and part of the Far East. And so unfortunately, during that time, Portuguese will lose a lot of its Indian sea trade monopoly. So here's the first, here we have the portrait of John, Duke of Braganza, who is going to become the one who is going to succeed to the Habsburg in 1640. His name will be John IV. He is proclaimed king and ends up that 60-year period of the House of Habsburg. This is also the beginning of the House of Braganza, which reigned in Portugal until 1910. His eldest son came to reign as Alfonso VI. But unfortunately for him, his physical and mental disabilities left him overpowered by a prime minister, Luis de Vasconcelos. Then you have the wife of the king who is going to take over. There is a very complicated succession line there. He is a portrait by Rubens of John I. He is going to be succeeded by Pedro II, but then within the succession line quickly comes King Joao V. This is painted by Pompeo Battoni, who was an Italian painter who came and worked in Portugal and in actually in Spain and Portugal. King Joao V becomes very quickly the Portuguese Sun King. As you can see, the whole attire, the fashion is very French. And he is not shying away from spending his money. He is the son of Pedro II, so the and will reign until 1750. Just an extraordinary example of work done in typical 18th century fashion is the ocean's coach used in the triumphal entry of the 1716 Portuguese envoy to Rome. And this was not the only carriage at that time. There were a whole series around there. So let's look at these buildings. And as I mentioned too, is often you have a very severe building, very simple. And then they come into more money and they build extraordinary porticos. So this is the church and the convent of São Gonçalo de Amarante. And you can see the portico in here, an even better picture, showing again that succession of columns and then the statues of saint in niches and finished by a little pediment that in a sense contrasts very much with the simplicity of the church around it. Entering the church, and these are always these incredible sight and shocks when you come into these very simple churches, and then you come and you have these amazing retablos, very rich, all covered with gold as the main altar and often in side chapels. Very interesting architecture here in Óbidos. This is mid 18th century, the church of the seniors is the man of the stone, if you want, because the main attraction to this church is an old cross that is also a miraculous cross. So really mixture of different styles. It's very interesting to see that mixture of a style. So the miracle comes from the fact that the region was experiencing a prolonged drought with a great damage to the agriculture. And then a farmer found a stone cross that became miraculous, and then asked from the cross came a message that they wanted a church to be built in that area. So it's a really mixture, very unique type of architecture, the design of the windows and the whole plan of the church is quite interesting. Here is the interior and the famous cross that was found, very simple cross with a very simple little design of a crucified Christ. We find in Portugal many churches that are circular churches or octagonal churches that in fact go back to the idea of perfect plan by Alberti that looked at the circular church as the perfect design. And so it's quite interesting that you find many here in Portugal. This is in Barcelos, and you have the outside small church showing more that the idea of Brunelleschi of the Pietra Serena, that bluish or dark stone on a lighter color stucco. again, the origin of the church is related to the mysterious appearance of a cross made of black earth on the fairground in 1504. So at first, the small chapel was built, and then 2 centuries later, they built the church, because you get pilgrimage then right away, people that are coming and try to get special graces. Now, this is really interesting because you're coming in and there are different sites with each different altar. So quite interesting inside. Very thick walls and heavy granite dome. In Lisbon itself, one of the early churches, the Baroque church, is the Church of Santa Ingracia, which by now has been turned into a pantheon. It has that kind of square shape from the outside and almost circular design inside. It was only converted in the 20th century as the national pantheon. So this is where all the important people are buried. So again, this is a church that inside benefited from some upgrades during the 18th century. And so some of the detailing that you find in the church are more Rococo. But of course, when you talk about Lisbon and the 18th century, the main big point is the 1755 earthquake, which absolutely flattened the city. And the interesting reaction at that time by somebody who is going to become the great figure of the 18th century in Portugal is going to say, what now? We bury the dead and take care of the living, and really push the city to go back. It very quickly had a program of reconstruction and in fact gave its name to a lot of the new architecture that's going to happen in Portugal at that time. Just to give you an idea, the estimated magnitude of the earthquake at the time was 8.5 to 9. That earthquake was so bad that, of course, not only Lisbon, but all the surroundings were damaged or destroyed. But it had a great impact on many people, including Voltaire in Europe, that something so dramatic could happen, really put things in perspective. And Voltaire was extremely marked by that terrible event. So the person who is going to really be the leader for Portugal after that terrible event is Pombal, the Marquis of Pombal. He is his portrait that literally and effectively ruled Portugal during the reign of King Jose I. Really quite enlightened in the way he handled things. So he's the great figure of enlightenment in Portugal. He was Secretary of State of Internal Affairs from 1750 to 1777, but he's really be de facto the head of the government. The Queen Consort was very fond of him, but so much that when he lost his first wife, she arranged for the second marriage to a very high-ranked lady. The king himself, John V, wasn't too pleased, and there was quite a bit of rivalry in between. So here is some of the buildings that we can find around Lisbon that are more of the typical of the 18th century. The Blem Palace, built in the 18th century, is now the official residence and workplace of the President of the Republic. Beautiful campus there. The Necessidades Palace houses the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And then more Pombaline, as we said, is the architecture here, that Praça de Comércio that houses multiple ministries of the government of Portugal. And it's along the river, as you can see. Now we're going to move a little bit out of Lisbon and look at some of the beautiful architecture around. This is north of Lisbon in Mafra, the enormous palace that was built by João V, also served as a Franciscan friary. And this goes on, this was the consequence of a vow that the king had made in 1711 to build a convent if his wife, Queen Mariana, gave him offspring. And this she did with the birth of their first daughter, the beginning of the palace began. So you have the church in the very center and then two wings that would contain some for the Franciscan friary as well as the apartments for the king and then a huge library also. The palace was designed by a German architect whose real name was Johann Friedrich Ludwig, that has been Portuguese, had the Portuguese flavor, becomes João Frederico Ludovice. So Ludovice, and again, I apologize, I can't pronounce Portuguese. So let's look inside the basilica. As you can see, a very large building, nave and the choir of the building, which is a mix of marble and granite stone, then multiple, either full dome and then half on the side, extraordinary design in there. And then four organs, actually no more. There's six or eight organs within that crossing area. The library, enormous library. This is it's one of the major libraries in Portugal that owns particularly 30,000 rare books on top of the rest of its content. We talked about the Queen, Maria I, Queen of Portugal, who had a very important role in some of the architecture and other buildings in Portugal. She disliked the Marquis of Pombal because he was just so powerful. And so when she came to the throne, she withdrew all his political offices and he died on his estate in 1782. So Queen Maria suffered from religious mania and melancholia. She was diagnosed contemporary, if you want. The people looked at what she had and assumed that she had what is called acute mental illness called porphyria. And because of that, she was unable to handle the state affairs after 1792. In May 1786, her husband died and she was devastated and forbade all court entertainments. After that, the Napoleon troops invaded Portugal And at the urging of the British government, the entire Braganza dynasty decide to flee on the 29th of November, 1807, to establish a government in exile in Brazil. And so she's very known in Brazil. She died actually in Rio de Janeiro in 1816 at the age of 81. But she is the reason why I'm talking particularly about her right now, is that she's the one who decided to change the little construction of Queluche that we see here. This is a view of Queluche in the 17th century in the new Versailles. And this, we've heard that again and again in Europe, Versailles became the example for rulers of what was the symbol of power. So we find all these little Versailles in Germany, in or large ones in Austria. We've seen some in Spain, and this is the one in Portugal. This is not very far. It's east of Lisbon, and it's a beautiful, not only nice ride, but also a lovely place to spend some hours. The Palacio Nacional de Queluche. The architecture, as you can see, is very Rococo. You have, I always love something that is most of the time lacking in France, but is the use of color that you find not only in Germany, but in Spain and in Portugal. The extraordinary gardens, the series of sculptures and fountains, a large collection of paintings, portraits of the family, unfortunately, family that was very much inbred and caused many people not to be the most handsome in the world. But here are more details of these beautiful fountains to dedicate to Neptunes and other deities. What is particular compared to other countries are the famous azulejos that you find in everywhere in Portugal. And this is what is was used as a grand canal, where they would, in the summer, just float on barges and go around it. And as you can see, they're lined with these extraordinary historiated tiles called the azulejos. And we'll see a little bit about it in a minute. These are polychromes, by the way, many colors. A view on the inside of the chateau. This is the throne room, a lovely tea room, where you can see paintings very similar to the one that Goya was doing in Spain. The azulejos hallway, where you have beautiful tiles from top to bottom, a beautiful music room with harpsichord. The chapel, as you can see, again, the combination of colors and the very ornate gold and the frames, very typical of the late Baroque. And then in the former kitchen of the palace is now a restaurant, Cucina Velha, that is absolutely extraordinary. And I really push you, if you go to Lisbon and you go to Queluche, do have lunch at in that kitchen, because the food is marvelous, but the decor is sensational. So a quick word on the azulejos. This is an example of the palace of the Marquis of Fronteira in Lisbon. So these glazed tiles was one of the best decorative arts in Portugal. A lot of buildings in the 16th and 17th century were lined with the tiles. And were bringing all that beautiful coloring. These techniques were introduced into Portugal by King Manuel I after a visit to Seville in 1503. And so they started the whole industry with this. and decorated, as I said, a lot of passes. This is another example. That's the same pass, but some details. So you can see these little ties form these magnificent designs of rearing horses. Or inside here is in a church of Misericord in Tavira, the extraordinary work of these azulejos. So going back to the architecture of the time, here just a series, and I've discovered a whole series of absolutely delightful little church. This is also around, not far from Lisbon, the Church of Our Lady of Lapa. It's been pretty difficult to do the research because there is very little said about it and very little images of the interior. So this was built on an old church, and it was rebuilt after a fire in the 17th century. But again, I love that contrast of the stucco wall with that granite or bluestone. The part of the great architecture of the 18th century is in Coimbra, the Joanine library building with a beautiful portico with two columns on each side. These are Ionic columns. And it's part of the great university in Coimbra. And you can see inside the stacks and the credenzas in the library. Porto is really the Baroque city by excellence. So even in the famous Cathedral of Porto, the Sé do Porto, that was started very early. We see that evolution of the church and the buildings around that end up being a Renaissance, or they open some larger windows. But then the portico was adapted to a Baroque architecture. So really that succession of styles, but because of the rather plain walls, they able to add some decorations. But there are definitely other churches, like the one, the Church of Clérigos, with a magnificent tower on the side, is a good example of the 18th century work with very ornated facade and broken pediments on the top, the little finials and niches, etc., that are accentuating the facade, the architecture of the facade, and the beautiful tower on the side. Also, as you can see, very simple on the bottom and then becomes more intricate with at its higher points. The Church of St. Francis in Porto with the torus columns at the entrance, and then you have the niche with St. Francis, has that unbelievable choir with golden retablo, but also coffered ceilings covered with gold. And of course, you can imagine that with the earthquake, a lot of it had to be rebuilt. Here is just an incredible ceiling, this old wooden sculpted wood. The Episcopal Palace, somebody really wants to reach me. Episcopal Palace of Porto, again, emphasis on the portico, but also they have added some decoration around each of the windows. And then inside you have a very typical, the coloring of the Rococo style, rounded pediment on top of the windows, and then the very pretty mixture of stucco work as well as paintings. In the surroundings of Porto is the palace of, and I don't know, Freixo, I'm not sure, palace that was built and juxtaposed to a manufacturer of soap manufacturer that existed at that time. And so the owner of the palace were also running the soap factory next to it. As you can see, you have the beautiful balcony, the contrast of the stone and the stucco, very typical of that period. Beautiful land also that on the river. So when you are in Porto and you look towards the outside from the bridge of Don Luis I, you can see that enormous monastery here with all the monastic buildings, and then the church that has this originally designed as a circular church. Here you can see it. And it's really interesting because not only is the church circular, but also we'll see that the cloister is circular too. This construction of the monastery site began in 1538 and was dedicated to the Order of St. Augustine. And then they enlarged it. As you can see, it's absolutely huge. The original monastery was completed in 1564 and the cloister were finished in 1583. And then they rebuilt the church that was inaugurated in 1672. And the final phases of the monasteries were finished by the end of the 17th century. As you can see, here is the church and then we have the cloister that is also circular, but all these others. Facilities for the monks. Inside the church, as you can see, the circular church, you have the very interesting dome and then multiple chapels in each part. Typically, you would have eight chapels where the monks could make the service for a different population. And here's a view of the cloister, as you can see, also circular. This all goes back again to the ideas of Alberti that the circular plan was perfection. So the Church of the Good Jesus of Matosinhos, again, very interesting architecture on the outside, the two lateral towers, a broken pediment, you know, the broken pediment that crowns the entrance, three entrances. Then you come in and you're overwhelmed by the inside work. This is also in the district of Porto. It's a pilgrimage church. The Palace of Mateus, and for those of you that like Portuguese wine, this is the place that gave its name to the Mateus Rosé. Absolutely beautiful small palace with its private chapel on the side, the extraordinary tower, you know, little towers at each corner of the roof, and then the double staircase going to the main entrance. This is north of Porto. The winery building dates from the 16th century and then were modified in the 18th century. Extraordinary grounds with Italian gardens and French gardens, and so you can see and wine vines that you can see at the forefront. And here and there are these wonderful churches. This is the, sorry, I didn't move that thing, but this is the church and then the portico that you can see here. Again, that contrast of the white stucco and the stone is really very becoming. And then you have these little towers and decoration, very typical of the 18th century. Now, if you go to the north of Portugal, you have Braga, the city of Braga. That was one of the main cities early on. We find here the church of St. Vincent in Braga. Was built in the 16th century and then restored at the end of the 17th century. Was actually built on the site of an old Visigothic church in the 7th century. Other beautiful 18th century church there, the Church of Santa Maria Maddalena. It's located in the Falperra Mountains outside of Braga. And you have again that almost like a retable on the front, and that contrast again of the granite and the stucco is absolutely beautiful. And many of these churches are just a variation on another theme, you know, on another. The most known, of course, is the huge church of Bon Jesus do Monte. So where you have to go up all these steps to get to the church. And each of them, on each of the staircases, you have some ideas of prayers and other, but beautiful decoration on them. So quite a climb there, good hiking there. In Braga itself, we have the High Palace that was ordered by a knight of the Order of Christ. He was also a rich merchant. Andres Soares was the architect, and he was the architect to many of the buildings we just saw before. You have here a contrast, not with the stucco, but with that kind of a tile-like facade. Beautiful sculptural program around it, and the same very Italian-looking guardrail on the top of the roof. Here's a view of the cherubs that are welcoming you on the balcony of the building. And inside, inside you can see that mixture of stone sculptures and the azulejos. And for whatever reason, I didn't give you the next image, which is the announcement to the next talk on the Thursday, which is going to be the 18th century architecture in the New World. So we will travel definitely to Mexico, Peru, Brazil, and see some of the legacy of what we saw today with the Churrigueresque architecture, which is going to have a tremendous impact in the new world. So we look at extraordinary buildings over there. My heart is going to Central and South America right now. So let me stop the recording.